Exclamation, everybody, and welcome back to Cube Ramblings. For me, it is Saturday night, August the 13th, 2016. I hope everyone has had an excellent week. I have had a busy week looking at many things, and we're going to be talking about a lot of stuff here, mostly No Man's Sky stuff, but there's a few other things that have happened. No Man's Sky came out on the PC finally this week on Friday, and I've played just over 2 hours of it, so we'll talk about that in a little bit. If you're watching this on YouTube, you've probably already noticed that the background game is, in fact, No Man's Sky and not Cube World as usual. But that's the way we're going to go for now, because that seems to be, I think I want to do that. I think that's the way I'm going to do that, from going forward here. But anyway, before we get too far into it, there is some news about Cube World. Actually, we did get a tweet from Wale, where he said he's working on the dungeons. He's got a new short preview up there. It's a little embedded video. It's about 30 seconds long on his Twitter of the preview of the dungeons. And he shows off several different dungeons. They are, you know, the way the dungeons and stuff are laid out now, it's more, you know, sort of realistic kind of. You know, like you go into castles and things like that. The ones he's showing off now look more fantastical than anything else. It's like a lot of platforming and just these large open expanses. It looks a little bit more like almost like a Zelda game in that respect. There's apparently some lava as well. Shows him taking a little dip in lava there. So new fluids we have coming, and other things like that. So it looks interesting. I was not expecting really the game to go in that kind of direction. It feels like we've gotten into a platforming game at that point, and I don't know exactly how I feel about that. But having dungeons and more varied dungeons is certainly a good thing. I just kind of thought that they were going to stick with, you know, more of a, you know, fantasy realm, not a, you know, comically, you know, expansive thing, like they have there. I was thinking more of, you know, castles and sieging castles then, and less, you know, Zelda-esque things, but, you know, it's to each their own, and it still seems like it would be a lot of fun to go through. At least until you fall off the platform for the 92nd time and have to get back on the land. But that's interesting. So some information there. Silence has been broken for at least a little bit here as far as Cube World is concerned. So there we go with that. Can link, mark that off the list. And now we can get down to business as far as No Man's Sky is concerned. So, as I said a little bit earlier, played about just over 2 hours of it. Haven't left the first world that I started on in, because I've been just having a lot of blast just exploring all the nooks and crannies that I come across. Like every time I come across a settlement, you know, three more pop up on the maps. I'm like, well, I gotta go look at those now. Plus I'm obsessed with getting like the blueprints for the Atlas keys, which I can't make yet, and yet there's 9,000 barrels lying on the ground that all require Atlas keys and stuff to access, and I'm like, I don't know how to make this thing yet. there has to be blueprints around here, damn it. So I keep looking around for that. I did upload eventually all the findings that I've had and renamed a few things just so that you know that it's mine, or at least that so that I get the credits for it. Apparently there's like in-game credits that you get for upgrades and stuff, and you get them through just discovering, but you have to upload your stuff in order for the credits to get marked on the account and all that stuff. So that is what I was doing that. So I got a little bit lazy with some of the naming, but for the most part I have a bit of a theme that I'm going on with that. So the first thing we probably should talk about is the performance of the game. So I, like many others, did have, when I first started the game, there was a lot of frame rate dropping going on and a lot of hitching. I was able to, once I figured out how the options menu worked, which it doesn't work like you would think it would. It's definitely a console port through and through with that, where you have to hold down your mouse button for like a half a second before it actually selects things. Because at first I was like, I clicked on something, I was like, why can I not change the, why would it give me the option of changing things and then not let me change things? And then I realized, no, I have to hold it down because it's got a little circle around it that has to fill up. So it's definitely got console-itis in that regard, which I was kind of worried, because they said, like, at the beginning of the week, like, hey, okay, we're getting ready for the PC release and we're releasing a patch where we actually have an options menu and stuff. I was like, what? you're releasing this on PC, you don't have an options menu yet, and you're a week away from launch. That's not good. And apparently, yeah, they just kind of bolted it on to the existing thing. They really did not pay the PC any heed in this. It was through and through a PS4 title that they just decided on a whim to say, yes, we're going to put this on PC. That said, after I was able to get some of the settings kind of tweaked a little bit, I went into the actual game directory, found the XML files that actually control the settings, and found that there was a hidden setting for G-Sync that I set to false, and that gave me some frame rate back. And then looking on Reddit and stuff, found that if you set it the frame rate limiter to max, which is basically turning it off, that you don't get a lot of the hitching goes away, because apparently, however, they frame rate limited, they did something that was just a little bit too non-performant to make it perform less. I don't know. So that's a pro. So that's those things were all settled, and managed to get into the game and get a fairly stable frame rate. I mean, it still kind of jiggles back and forth a little bit too much for my taste, but it's not. It only gets choppy at certain points, and it seems like to me the points when it gets choppy is when it actually has to dig into its procedural generation to do stuff. Namely, if you look up in the sky and there's going to be a moon there, it will freeze for like a half a second or so while it generates that moon and puts it in the sky. And then you can continue on with whatever you were doing prior to that. So it seems like they must have, you know, the algorithm that they supposedly, you know, had to pay royalties on but didn't have to, and all that stuff. It appears that algorithm is wildly inefficient, or at least possibly IO bound. I haven't put any of my probes on it to see if there's any like IO contention or anything going on. I mean, there shouldn't be on my machine, because even though I'm recording, I record to a separate hard drive that is on a separate bus. So I don't get any bus contention, and my main drive is a non-magnetic drive. What is it? Solid state drive. That's the word I was looking for. So there shouldn't be a whole lot of contention there, but it does seem like possibly it's writing a lot to disk. And, you know, for a machine that has 24 gigs of RAM available to it, that seems a bit odd. But I imagine that has something to do with a PS4 quirk that they have brought over to the PC side of things, possibly. So that might be the thing. I'm not entirely sure or not. It does appear to be only a thing that happens, at least for me, when the procedural generation kicks in. The other thing about the game, so it does drop you right into the game without any real explanations, which is fine. You can kind of figure out things. But it does have, it is a little obtuse in its execution. You will get a message that says, hey, if you've pre-ordered it, you get the message saying, hey, you've got stuff to redeem. And it says, go into the options menu to redeem it. And you go into the options menu and it's, it, you have to clue into the redeem part, because it says redeem bonus content in there, and that's what you have to actually click on, and then that gives you access to a new ship if you want it. I decided to take it with the knowledge that the ship that they give you has a hyperdrive on it, and you don't know how to build a hyperdrive, so if it ever gets damaged, you are screwed until you find the blueprints for it. So I knew that going in, so I've been trying to scan around looking for blueprints whenever possible, in the hopes that I can find that. Plus, I want to find that damn Atlas key so I can open up all these other crates that are lying around that say, this requires an Atlas key V1, and this requires an Atlas key V2, and all that stuff. So all that's been going on. Been doing lots and lots of just exploring on foot. Eventually got the fighter ship all repaired, and the planetary flying is really bad. I don't know, I haven't left the planet yet, so I don't know what it's like out in space, but the planetary flying is just terrible. It's you fly with the mouse, kinda. What happens is the game actually puts you at, when you take off, it automatically puts you at a sort of minimum limit that you can fly at. So it's like you eventually get to a point, if you angle yourself down enough, you'll eventually get to a point where the game will just level you off entirely. You won't be able to go any lower than that until you hit E to automatically land. So it's kind of weird in that respect when you're using the mouse and keyboard. I don't know if that's the same with a controller or not, but I have no real desire to play it with a controller. So that's where that goes. I don't think there's any joystick support in the game, honestly. I didn't see any if there was, so I haven't pulled the joystick out either to do that. But it doesn't look like it would be very easy to control anyway, even with a joystick. So I feel like the control scheme is really made for, not for planetary stuff, but for the space stuff, hopefully. So we'll see what that looks like when I eventually get out to space, which I haven't done yet. Over 2 hours of footage, still haven't gone out into space, and probably still won't go out to space for a little while, because I still have more outposts and stuff to look at. As you go around the world, you find alien artifacts, which give you words of their language, so you can learn their language. There's outposts that you come across that have aliens on there, like NPCs that you can communicate with, and that'll give you presents and that you can trade with and all that stuff. There's trade bots, automated trade bots that you can trade with. The one big no-no that I have is I am not a fan of Inventory Tetris. I thought, honestly, that Inventory Tetris was the worst kind of inventory management you could ever put in a game. Well, Hello Games has proven me wrong. They managed to find an even worse inventory management thing here, which is basically they give you a bunch of squares, and it looks a little bit like Destiny in that regard, like the UI treatment. But they give you a bunch of squares, and you have to click on the squares and hit E, or roll over them with the mouse and hit E to, like, either craft stuff, or if you want to transfer stuff between your ship and your backpack, or from your backpack to the ship, you hit X and it transfers into that slot. And things don't automatically stack, so you have to, if you have three different stacks of, say, plutonium, you have to transfer like one or two of them into the inventory, right, into different slots. You have to have like two slots open. Then you can click on it and then click on the other one, and then it'll combine into one slot. And then you got to do it again for the other one. You got to put that into the empty slot, the third one, and then click it for the other one. You click on those two to combine them again. It's a real pain in the neck. It's the worst inventory management I've ever seen in my life. It's annoying as hell. And a lot of things just don't stack. Like you open up crates and you'll get these damn pleasure balls or pearls or whatever the hell they are, whatever they're called, and they don't stack, right? And they just take up room. You get a lot of stuff that you can trade off for money, which is great, but it all takes up one slot. You can't combine anything. It's you spend so much time just trying to manage these freaking inventories, it's just a pain in the neck. It really is. And I know that later on in the game, you get more inventory space. You'll find ships with more inventory space and all that stuff. And that's great. But it's still, you're still stuck with this inventory scheme that is just horrible. And to top it off, it will, when you're transferring items, like even in the small inventory that I have for the fireship that I have, if I want to transfer items from my backpack to the fighter ship, and that the only things on the fighter ship, the only free slots on the fighter ship are the lower slots on the screen, when you hit X, it will put the transfer screen right next to your mouse cursor, which is always off the screen, right? Like half of it's off the screen. So it's like you can't, you know, they didn't constrain the inventory to the actual visible screen. They didn't give you a scroll bar or anything like that. It just goes off the screen. You can't do anything. You can't click on anything. You can't move stuff around. It's a real pain in the neck. A real pain in the neck. It's horrible. I don't know who playtested that inventory screen and thought, yeah, this is great. But it's not. It is anything but great. It is the worst thing I've seen in my life. And I'm being nice here saying that, because it's just not. Like, I'm not a fan of the inventory Tetris, but I would take inventory Tetris over the scheme that they've come up with. I mean, seriously, it's bad. It's just really bad. And it makes the game a slog. Because what I end up doing is, you know, fill up the inventories as best as I can, and then just I have to constantly make trips over to the trader to trade off things, and then come back, and it's just, you end up recharging your health or recharging your life support and stuff when you don't need to, just to free up space, because it just gets to be annoying that you don't have any space to do anything. You need free space in order to craft stuff, and a lot of things in the game require like keys that you craft. And every time, without fail, when I go to craft something, my inventory is full, so I gotta go play this damn game where I'm like, oh I can't transfer anything over to my ship because that's full too. So now I gotta go find a trader, get rid of some things, come back to my ship, grab stuff off of that, find another trader, you know, sell that stuff off, come back, then get back to what I was doing in the first place, which is crafting a freaking key, and then use that key immediately to unlock a beacon and all that stuff. It drives you nuts a little bit after a while of doing it, after a while of dealing with that. Another hot tip I ended up accidentally stumbling on is that if you start up the game, because I start up the game and I started recording and stuff and making sure my recording was working and changing the options menu and trying to get that tweaked. Turns out, if you don't save your game, you'll get another new randomly generated world every time. So I've seen like maybe 5 or 6 different worlds as I've tried to fix my options menus and stuff. And a lot of the ones that you start off on are really hostile. Like, there was one that was like, it was a like hell planet, and you were like dying almost immediately on it. And I was like, well, I'm not going to save this. I'm going to just go back. I'm going to quit the game. I'm going to come back in and it'll generate me somewhere else. And so when you look at my playthrough, you'll see that I'm on a planet that's really, really nice and favorable and doesn't have any like negative effects on it. Really. It's a good temperate climate, and I'm able to find things. There's nothing really impeding my progress. Rest assured that I gamed the system a little bit, and I did not start recording until I found a planet that was like that. I may have quit out of the game several dozen times before I finally got a planet that I was comfortable on for my noobishness. So there you go on that. I did slightly bend the rules a little bit there. But I completely stumbled on that by accident, because I was just trying to get the options menu working at first. And when I noticed it was giving me on different planets, which makes sense, I realized that, oh yeah, I can use this to my advantage. I don't have to disadvantage myself directly. I can find a nice little planet to call my own. So that's what I did. And then I proceeded to call it William Adama and Caprica as the plant name. So I guess I didn't really call it my own, did I? You won't see that footage actually at all, because I did that off camera. But that's it's a pretty interesting. I'm trying to name things after sci-fi characters, and I didn't realize you had to name like all the different like areas that you found. So I was like, yeah, I'll just like, you know, I'll just call them alpha, beta, gamma, delta, you know, all that stuff. But the plant names, I'm trying to take plant names from actual science fiction stuff, and for, you know, the system names, I'm trying to name systems after sci-fi characters, character names. So there's going to be a running theme if I go, and as I go out into the universe. So you may end up, if you have No Man's Sky, end up running across something that goes, why would you name this system that? It was probably me. It was probably me. But anyway, what else about it? So gathering, it's just a resource gathering thing. The resources are fairly plentiful, at least on the planet that I'm on. Haven't really had any problems with that. I have gone 2 hours without actually scanning anything, and I didn't realize that C was actually to scan. I must have said that at some point in time, and I didn't catch it. And I went online, I was looking at some articles, reading some articles, and people are like, oh yeah, you just C to scan things. I'm like, oh, I did not even realize that. Normally I look in options menus to see what the keys are bound to, but I didn't this time around, and there you go. There's a whole another part of the game that I didn't even realize was there. I mean, I had a scanner, but I thought it was doing it automatically. I didn't realize I had to keep pinging it with C, the keyboard. So there you go. There was that, and I see, you know, other people who have been playing the game seem to be having some of the same issues, where it's like trying to figure out the game, because the game doesn't really tell you anything, and it's like, oh, you kind of do this and you kind of do that. But if you've played enough, you know, sandbox games, you pretty much understand what you're doing. You're just collecting stuff and you're going around and exploring. And I like the exploration games. I like the games that reward you for exploring. I guess that's why I've played Cube World for so long, is because I still get the sense of exploration when I do that. Whereas in Minecraft, when they redid the terrain generation, that was lost. Like the terrain was no longer as interesting as it used to be whenever you go around. So it kind of took away from a lot of the exploration aspect, and the fact that, you know, all the things that you would explore for, like the, I mean, desert temples notwithstanding, but like the you know, end temples or fortresses, I mean, they until recently were only generating within like 1,000 blocks of spawn, and that's it. You know, there's only 3 of them, which really didn't encourage you to go exploring, honestly. And the surface stuff, like, oh, there's another you know, jungle temple, or there's another you know, desert temple, or there's another village, not really that compelling. Whereas in Cube World, it's kind of a little bit more compelling, because A, the terrain generation is a lot nicer, and B, you can run across like a castle, or you can run across a crazy, you know, overpowered bunny that's killing everything around it. You know, it's just that kind of thing that kind of keeps you going, keeps you wanting to explore more. And No Man's Sky has some of that, at least initially. But already, you know, 2 hours into it, I can already see the repeats. Like, a lot of this stuff are prefabbed. You know, like, you've seen one outpost, you've seen them all, pretty much. You know, you can see all the prefab stuff that they threw in there, and they're reusing. And, you know, I can't fault them for that, because that's, you know, making assets is hard, and making assets that work, you know, 60 hours into a procedurally generated game is next to impossible. Not entirely impossible, but it's very, very difficult. I would have to look at, I mean, even if you look at something like Crashlands, you know, the tile sets in that, you know, having the 3 different areas in Crashlands helped, where it still felt a little bit fresh every time you were, you know, you were 30 hours into the game, you felt like you were still kind of fresh, but they still reused all the functionality of things. Like, it was just, it was a grind up to that point, and it was a continuation of that grind where it's like, all right, now you need this table to build this stuff, and you need that table to build that stuff, and that table is pretty much the same as the last table you saw, except it's a reskin of it. And, you know, there's always going to be, in a procedurally generated thing like that, there's always going to be some kind of rehash, of reuse and all that stuff. Very difficult to not make that be the case without handcrafting stuff. That said, I'm still enjoying the exploration aspect of the game. And I, because I'm still early into it, I knew going in that it wasn't really a multiplayer game. And I'm surprised that a lot of people were confused and thought that it was a multiplayer game when it's really not. I mean, I know that they, you know, the creator had said, you know, devs had said, oh yeah, we're, you know, the only way you're going to be able to tell what you look like is through the eyes of another player, which was a lie. But, you know, it's, they didn't really go into any depth about the game for a long time. And so whenever like multiplayer would come up, I think the community put words in their mouth as far as that. It's like, oh yeah, it's going to be a great multiplayer experience. It's going to be like Elite Dangerous and all that stuff. It's like, no, not really. No, I never got that impression from anything that was said that it was going to be like an Elite Dangerous. And honestly, I'm kind of glad it wasn't, because it's at least it's not as boring as Elite Dangerous was. Like, I played, if I compared the 2 hours I've played of Elite Dangerous to the 2 hours I played of No Man's Sky, I will continue playing No Man's Sky. Because Elite Dangerous is boring as shit. I mean, it was really, really boring. And even though it has a superior multiplayer experience, if you can call it that, I mean, everybody's playing in their own little sandboxes. because nobody wants to be out in open, in Elite Dangerous open, because they just get ganked and then lose all the progress that they've made, which I still say no to corpse runs. Always say no to corpse runs. I know Star Citizen's going to be doing something similar, but they're going to have, you know, insurance that you on your ships and stuff like that. So, I guess that's a mea culpa, but still, you know, say no to corpse runs, please, no more corpse runs. That was a multiplayer holdover for, you know, what was it? Was it Ultima Online or EverQuest or one of those that originally did it? And they did it because they wanted to be able to reward players for PvPing, and the reward was you got to pick, you know, stuff off of a player's corpse, and that's why you had to do corpse runs. And ever since then, there's been no excuse for these other games to do corpse runs. I mean, seriously, there is no excuse at all. Like, you're playing a little bit of Starbound, and I'm playing it in casual mode because I don't want to do corpse runs. It's stupid. It's a single-player game. I mean, yes, it has some multiplayer on it, but it's a single-player game. It shouldn't be in there. That should not be a thing. That does not make your game hard. It makes it annoying as shit, is what it does. It does not make it any more difficult. It just makes it very frustrating to the point where you want to just quit it, and you don't want to play anymore. And that's the same thing with that. Now, thankfully, so far, well, I mean, I don't know for sure, actually, to be honest with you, because I haven't died yet in No Man's Sky. So I don't know if there's corpse runs in it. I want to say that it probably isn't. But again, I haven't died yet, so, because I haven't picked any fights. There's a lot of sentinels flying around, but I haven't picked any fights with them. I saw another YouTuber, like, immediately start shooting sentinels with his mining laser, and I was like, well, that's how you not make friends in the universe when you first start. That was pretty funny, though. It was interesting. I mean, so far there's a lot of like those graphical things with stuff off the screen. Whenever you come across a milestone, like the entire screen like shifts to it and it's like, hey, you have walked 15,000 units, and then it for like 20 seconds it's on your screen, you can't do anything, and you're like, okay, I get it, I got an achievement, like, go away now. I get that I got an achievement, please leave. You know, you could have just as easily popped something up in the corner and said, hey, congratulations, here's an achievement. You know, you didn't have to take over my controls and say, oh, you have walked this long. It's like, I know I have. I did it myself just a few minutes ago. You don't have to remind me. So that is so far what has been going on with that. I know a lot of people have been having issues with the game, issues trying to get it to work, issues with the frame rate. The PC is not very well represented as far as the code for this game is concerned. I still think that there's some IO contention going on there. I don't have any hard evidence of that. I do know that the procedural generation code seems to be the thing that's it seems whenever that kicks in, the frame rate goes to hell. And the other like small problem that I have with it is it does have, and you might notice this when you're looking at the video, it does these, there's a lot of shaders in the game, and there's certain shaders, you know, obviously the game is better for some of that, but there's some that that a lot of games have been using lately that just pisses me off. And one of them is, you know, one of them is snow, putting snow on your screen. It's like, I'm sorry, but I paid a lot of money for this. I don't want snow on my screen. Thank you. Please let me turn that off. Depth of field is another one. It's like, yes, let's make the game look shitty. Like, no, I would like to see what I'm looking at. Thank you. I don't need depth of field. It's not more realistic. You don't do it right anyway. You've never done it right. Stop trying to pretend that you do it right. You don't. Let me turn that off. The other thing, and this is in No Man's Sky, you probably see it. There's horizontal lines across the screen, like almost like tracking lines, sort of, like you would get from an old VCR almost, or like a CRT screen. And I get that it's a stylistic choice to do that, but please stop doing that. Because it makes your game look ugly. It makes it look unfinished. It's annoying to constantly look at your HUD and see that. It's just stop doing that. This is supposed to be a space game. We're supposed to be, you know, in the future. We don't get CRT lines in the future. Stop that. Stop it. Don't even think about it. Just remove it. And I actually went, it annoyed me enough that I went into the game folder and I tried to figure out if I could find out what shaders, all the shader files are in there. And I was trying to figure out what shader file does that and if I could just move it out of that directory and suddenly the game wouldn't do that anymore. I suspect the game's just going to crash if I try it, but I was seriously considering it because it was just annoying to me. And I'm sure rendering this out is going to be fun in games because it's probably going to take, you know, 3 hours longer to render because of that damn, you know, there's no frames of it that don't have a ton of motion in them. You know, I mean, things render faster when there's a lot of static frames. But anyway, that's where we stand on that. That's so far how I've gotten into No Man's Sky. It's, as far as, am I enjoying myself? Yes. I've enjoyed it so far. I think I've enjoyed it more that I'm not doing an actual Let's Play of it. I think I enjoy it more as I get to play this. I happen to be recording what I'm playing, but I'm listening to something else and I'm just kind of chilling and just playing it. I don't have to worry about being on a live stream where I'm trying to be entertaining. I don't have to worry about, you know, recording and, you know, for YouTube and getting a whole bunch of progress done and showing lots of progress. It's nice I'm just going to sit here and chill and just enjoy exploration aspects of it. And I think I enjoyed it for that purpose. I don't know how long that's going to last, but so far so good, I would say, on that. I'm going to, as a programming note here, I'm going to continue to record No Man's Sky and use that as the background for this series going forward, at least for the foreseeable future. Maybe sometime in the future, if I do get tired of No Man's Sky, I'll come back to Cube World. But I don't see that happening anytime soon. I've seen pretty much all there is to see in Cube World. I'm walking to what I think are far lands, but I may never there may not be such a concept in Cube World. So I've been just kind of just trucking along. It's just there. It's a thing for me to play from time to time. I still enjoy it, but it's there are several recording sessions where I have actually fallen asleep playing the game because it gets so samey at points. I assume eventually I'll get to that point with No Man's Sky, but I mean, it took me 2 years, 2.5 years. No, I'm sorry. We just celebrated 3 years now. 3 years to get to that point with Cube World. So I imagine, you know, with No Man's Sky continuing to be updated and there's patches that have been planned for, they're apparently going to be doing some building aspect in there too, possibly. With that going on, with active development, with active patches going out to people and not a whole lot of smoke and mirrors, I can see that possibly being 3 years as well, if not more. So there you go on that. That is where I stand. That's where I stand thus far. So, it's an interesting week for fan games, for fan created creations, and a terrible month for them. So earlier in the month, there was a fan made take on Mega Man 2, I believe, or was it? No, Metroid 2 it was. A take on Metroid 2 that was promptly DMCA'd and removed. And then this week saw a fan-made Pokemon game called Pokemon Uranium. I'll leave you a link to the Kotaku article talking about it. And I'm also going to leave you a link to the message that they left saying, sorry, but we had to take the links down. So they were also DMCA'd. They did not get a cease and desist. However, they were getting threatened by legal action. It's basically a game that they've been working on for 9 years and trying to get it released. It reminds me a lot of... It's kind of like the Wing Commander community where, you know, people have been working on stuff for long periods of time and then it gets released. And I think the nice thing with the Wing Commander community is that it's niche enough that it never gets picked up by the mainstream press when somebody releases something. So it gets to stay up for longer. Whereas something like Pokemon or Metroid are very, very mainstream, very AAA. And as soon as some fan releases something that they've been, the labor of love that they've been working on for years and years, you know, a rush of people come in, download it, and then it promptly goes kaput because the lawyers come a knocking. And it sounds like about 1.5 million people managed to download Pokemon Uranium. There are videos of the game, and I believe there are probably some YouTubers doing Let's Plays of it. And I went to try to actually download it, because even though I don't like Pokemon, I like to look at you know, fan-made stuff. And couldn't do it. There are no more links. The links are all gone. They all go to nothing anymore. So that is unfortunate. That's very, very unfortunate. Very unfortunate to see something like that get canned by the legal teams, especially since it was being given away for free. There was a multiplayer aspect to it. The team behind Pokemon Uranium says that if you have downloaded it, they are going to continue to release patches for it. They're just not going to release the full game anymore. And the multiplayer servers for it, because it has a multiplayer aspect to it, will continue to work. So congratulations if you manage to download it. If you haven't, I would be very, very, very careful if you try to look for it in the shady corners of the internet, because eventually someone's going to say, hey, this is a good way to get our malware onto people's systems. So just be very, very cautious with it. So there's that. Then on slightly happier news, another fan-made project, GoldenEye Source, came out this week. It was a multiplayer mod for the Source engine for GoldenEye, 007 GoldenEye. So what they did was, you know, they didn't take the single-player missions out of the game. They just rebuilt the multiplayer arenas that the game provided. and they rebuild it in the Source engine, and you know, fans did, and they're giving it away for free, and you can go in and play against other players in a GoldenEye looking thing. They rebuilt the various levels that were available. I think there's like 25 arenas or something that they have in there. They're all levels from the original game, but they didn't bring any of the single player stuff over, which I think was more of a strategic, probably more of a strategic move on their part. Like, hey, we might be able to get away with releasing a multiplayer thing that's just based on their maps, and not, you know, if we try to release the single player game, we're probably going to get taken down. So far, I think that link is still active and still working. So I would rush in there as fast as you can and download that if you're looking for the old classic GoldenEye 007 multiplayer goodness that you can't really get anymore. So there's that. And for more port news, Star Trek Online. We have more information about the console port that is coming up for Star Trek Online for both the PS4 and the Xbox One. I'll link it to Hardcore Gamer. They give you a little bit of information on it. They also have an embedded video that talks about the changes that have been made to Star Trek Online to enable it to be used with a console controller. It's pretty significant. They had to rebuild the entire UI. They have radial menus now for things. The gameplay is like, you know, is a little bit more like the view is a little bit more fixed. It looks like than it is with the mouse and keyboard, where you can float around a lot and look at all different areas. It looks like it's more like the camera's kind of more stable behind your ship, and your ship is just kind of moving around like that, which actually I kind of prefer a little bit better than the way they have it now. So that's all cool. They've been doing some revamps on the lighting engines, which I think they've been doing. I think they've been slowly rolling that out to the game as it is, because it seems to me like the game looks a lot better than I remember it, and it seems like it's getting better. Like, there's constantly large patches coming down, and I think that they are live patching a lot of that, the visual updates and the lighting updates into the PC game as it is. So things are looking really nice now in the game. They're really updating the engine to make it look good on the consoles. The news about the multiplayer, news about it though is it'll be free. Completely free. No subscriptions required, except if you're on the Xbox. So on PS4, it doesn't require PS Plus? It doesn't require that. So you don't need a subscription to that. On the Xbox One, though, you will need a gold subscription in order to do the multiplayer. From what I understand, it seems like that. So even though they say in the video that you don't need a subscription, they really mean you don't need a subscription to Cryptic. You just need, or to Perfect World. You just need you might need a subscription on Xbox One to Xbox Gold, Xbox Live Gold, which honestly kind of pays for itself a little bit, in that you get a lot of free games as well with it. So, you know, every month there's a free game, couple free games to download. Some of them aren't that bad either. So, you know, it's one way or the other there. Half of one, three halves of another, or however that phrase is coined. That's pretty cool. That's all looking really nice. I don't know if they're going to make the controller available for the PC stuff. I suspect maybe not, because the UI was completely overhauled. But it would be kind of cool if they did, but I'm not holding my breath out for that. And honestly, the way it controls on the PC is good enough. I mean, it's not ideal. I don't particularly like the sort of WoW-like controls that they have, but and all the icons and stuff. But it's, after you get used to it, it's kind of hard to pick it apart when you're used to it by now. So that is more information on that. More information on Deus Ex Mankind Divided. First of all, we got two pieces of information here. Deus Ex Go, which is the mobile mobile Deus Ex game. It's coming out on the 18th, so very, very shortly. They just gave us the date very early, without a whole lot of time to think about it. That's coming on August 18th for mobile devices. That is a that's in the same genre as the other Go games. So like Lara Croft Go and Hitman Go. And I think there was another one too that I don't remember. But it's going to be in the same style of those, which is they're semi, they're like turn-based semi-puzzle games, kind of, where you have like a 2D board, you know, isometric board, and it looks like sort of cardboard cutouts, kind of, and you move your character along one space at a time, and other enemies and other things move at the same time that you move, kind of like a roguelike almost. And you, based on how other things are moving in the world, you have to time your movements around the board to get through those obstacles and stuff. It looks like this is probably going to be much the same thing. So if you're a fan of Deus Ex, you might want to take a look at that. I've played Hitman Go, and it was a lot of fun. And Lara Croft Go was actually pretty good too. So far so good on that, on the track record with those. In addition to that, news on those of us who have pre-ordered Deus Ex Mankind Divided, we can preload it on the PC. We can preload it on the 19th. If you have pre-ordered it on the PS4 or the Xbox, I believe it's the 21st when you're allowed to preload. And then the game itself launches on the 23rd. So you can go ahead, preload it early, get everything done, ready to go, and then jump into it immediately on the 23rd as you can. So I am hyped. I am stoked. I am waiting and ready to do my part in the the robot, the mankind. What was the thing, mechanical apartheid fighting back against it, as they said in their trailers. So because I enjoyed Deus Ex Human Revolution a lot, and of course I enjoyed all the other games too. I was the one that enjoyed the Deus Ex 2 and did a whole playthrough of that. The one that people forget is actually there for reasons, and I enjoyed that even on my second playthrough. I've been trying to play the original Deus Ex with the revision Deus Ex revision, the modded one, but it's the lighting is not coming through on my recordings. It's very, very dark in the recording, so I've been trying to figure out how to fix that. Because it's not that dark on my screen, but apparently they've got some kind of post-processing that goes into the gamma, and DX Tori must insert itself prior to that in the rendering pipeline, and so it's everything's coming out really dark. So I've decided I need to go back and revisit that. I'll probably look at maybe recording it either with Shadow Play or with the OBS Studio. Possibly. So look at those. Also a little side note, little how the sausage is made. Apparently in Windows 10, Shadow Play does not break your games up, break your videos up into 3 gig pieces. It puts it all on one video now, which is like, hey, awesome. Finally you did something right. Now it's on par with everything else. So just a little note there on that. But anyway, that's what I have as far as Deus Ex Mankind Divided. This week, as far as side quests go, I played Poi, which I am going to come back to. I most definitely want to come back to it and play through it. It's a platforming take on, it's early access, it's platforming, it's a take on sort of Super Mario 64 and a little bit of Super Mario Sunshine, and games of that genre, and it's putting it on PC, basically games of that genre put on PC. It's actually a lot of fun. I was enjoying myself in it. Your character is very very maneuverable. The controls are really tight, especially on the controller. The keyboard's not too bad, but the controller, especially with the flight mechanics, the controller is superior with that. And it was fun. I really enjoyed my time in it. It's still early access, so I'm gonna wait for that to get out of the oven, hopefully, and eventually. And I'm gonna definitely do a series on that because I really enjoyed that. I've been wanting something like Super Mario 64 on the PC for a while. I've actually been wanting something like Super Mario RPG on PC for a while because I played that in an emulator too, in the Mupen emulator. And I enjoyed the heck out of that. Like, I played that game all the way through to the end, and even put up with that freaking last boss battle that used to, that was pissing me off for a week trying to beat that damn guy. And I finally did it. So it's a testament that I hung in that long to beat the final boss that I actually, how much I enjoyed that game. I really like to see something like that, on the PC at some point. Because that was a whole lot of fun. And then this one was like Super Mario 64. That was also a lot of fun. I didn't play too much of it because it was kind of samey. But this one has got me. I'm kind of interested. I know it's a little bit samey. You're kind of revisiting the same levels over and over and over again. But it's still... It feels compelling. It's still compelling in its own right, I guess, is what I'm getting at there. It still feels good to play. So, got that. I wanted to get another video out this week, but I failed. I've been playing Overcooked. That's another one. I know enough about it now that I can start a video of it, but I was kind of testing it out first and then I just ran out of time to do a good proper video on it, so that will be coming sooner rather than later. Also continuing to play the Solace Project. I recorded some of that a little bit earlier today, Saturday, so hopefully that will go up on Sunday so you can take a gander at that, or maybe that'll go up on Monday actually, because Sunday I've got The Descendant. I play through episode 3 of The Descendant, and it was okay. They've changed their voice acting, so they actually have some proper voice acting now, but the story just went off the rails entirely. It was threadbare to begin with, and it was kind of janky, but it was still competent, and then suddenly it's just like, it's non-existent almost. It's like it's taking a break for a little bit. It's like the game was only supposed to be maybe 4 episodes, but this is the filler episode to make it 5 because someone wanted a round number, I guess. I don't know. It just doesn't feel very interesting. It feels like as soon as you jump into the game, it goes off the rails. It's like suddenly this guy is crazy pants. And he's acting crazy pants, and you're like, well, what was this? This was, there was no indication that this thing was even coming, and now we're suddenly here, and it's just it just kind of doesn't really hold together too well. And then, you know, then the second half of the game, you're just doing basically going from one puzzle to the next, and even puzzles that you don't think should even be there, like trying to find the right path through a freaking storage area. It's like, why is this a thing? Why? I mean, I get that you wanted another puzzle in there, but really, why is this a thing? It doesn't make a lot of sense. But it's just, I don't know. It just kind of, I don't know if they figured out whether they want to be a point and click game or a puzzle game. And the story is just all over the map. So it's kind of hard to call it a point and click game because, you know, usually there's some kind of story there, and this one is just kind of, it's taking a break, I guess. I don't know. I don't know how else to put it. It's kind of lost its way a bit. That said, the voice acting is much improved. It's just they don't have much material to work with, honestly, is what it seems like it's coming to. So hopefully they'll do a little revamp, another rough draft maybe of their next episode before it comes out. So that it gets back on track and gets back to whatever theme it was trying to do. Like, it introduced a bunch of stuff in episode 2, and then episode 3 is just like, let's go off and do something else entirely. Let's go take spend a weekend with our crazy Uncle Fred. It's like, what? Why are we over here? We were talking about some conspiracy earlier. Now we're like, no, here's the crazy guy. It's like, what? What did I miss here somewhere? I don't know that I missed anything, but it was very jarring the way it fleshed out there and how it worked. But anywho, that brings you up to speed so far on things. Actually, speaking of the Solace Project, it's getting good. It's like, you know, I mean, it's a walking simulator through and through, but it's starting to, like, the pieces that they've been sort of, like, spoon-feeding you just a little bit here and there, are starting to come together, and you're starting to see more of a picture, and, like, the main character's actually commenting now on things, and kind of wrapping up the story and how everything looks and what's going on. So, yay. Also, I'm hoping that I don't have to deal with the freaking smoke monster again. But it's, you know, going through those tunnels is a real pain in the neck when you're trying to, you know, avoid all the things. So, making some progress there on that. I don't know how much more there is of that left. But it's, I'm enjoying it still. I just have to, it's just getting the time to do it. The same thing goes with, the Elder Scrolls Online. I have not forgotten about it. It's just that I had all this other stuff that I wanted to get out. Like, I wanted to get all my recordings out of, Minecraft story mode, and I wanted to get the Descendant out there because, you know, they just kind of sit around on your disc for a while, and it's like, okay, at some point this has got to go out the door. So that's what I'm doing there, just kind of clearing the plate a little bit. So Elder Scrolls Online will be coming back soonish, hopefully. And continuing to play Starbound. It's slow going. I noticed, I was looking at some other YouTuber playing through it, and they're on like episode 6 or something, and they just beat the boss that I beat in episode 2, and I'm like, okay, clearly I'm not playing his game correctly, because I struggled mightily with that boss, and they just kind of waltzed on through and just did their thing, but they were far more geared up than I was, so clearly I'm doing it wrong somewhere along the way, but that's going to continue to be just a once a week thing. I know that kind of kills a lot of people, because they're like, hey, we really like sandbox games, and but you don't give them enough love. And yes, I agree, but they take so much time, and I have so little time that I can't be consistent with them if I do them more than once a week. If I do more than once a week, I end up not getting a whole lot done in one of those episodes. Whichever episode it's going to be, it ends up not getting a whole lot done. So it's kind of half of this and five quarters of that, or whatever that phrase is. I still have not gotten that phrase right, even at the end of this episode. But anyway, I have rambled on, I think, long enough for one day. Plus, I am sweating my patootie off. Hottest day of the year here, of course. So, I got computers running, and it's the hottest day of the year. Computers belching out heat, hot air, two things are not working out so well for me at the moment. But anyway, thanks so much for watching, everybody, or listening on SoundCloud, and I will see you next Sunday.